Ladies and gentlemen, now we will hear the first keynote speaker for today, Professor Jean Michelin from Leuven University, Belgium. To be honest with you, when I read some of the material and articles that he wrote about making and decolonizations of schools, I understood, but we need indeed an expert in order to illuminate more and cast light on this issue. Please welcome with me to the podium Professor Jean Michelin. Please.
Sabah Kar? No, not correct. I try to say good morning. I'm sorry. I apologize. So I will speak in English. I apologize for that. And I first of all want to thank the organizers of the conference for their invitation. It is a great honor and in fact also quite a challenge. I am indeed not sure whether I will be able to meet your expectations. So coming from Belgium, I'm a real outsider regarding the situation. And I think it's very likely that I'm going to imply some wrong assumptions. So I want to apologize for that before I start. But in order to try at least to some extent to avoid that, I will take a more distant point of view, although I hope that it can resonate with some of your concerns, the practical and the political ones. In my presentation, I will mainly deal with the notion of school itself. If we want to think about teacher education, about the identity of the teacher, and we mean the school teacher, then it is important to address the notion of school itself. The school teacher does not only have to teach, she has also to make school. And school is not facilitating learning, but it is complicating learning. And that's a crucial thing about the school. So he has to learn, or she has to learn also, how to make school. And I will talk about how to make school and how we could conceive of teacher education in this respect. And I think this is indeed a crucial public issue today, not only in this context, but more broadly, as the school is confronted with all kinds of attempts to tame it and colonize it. So I will build upon some ideas that I have developed together with my colleague Martin Simons in a little book which was called In Defense of the School. As you all know, although the school has often stood as a symbol of progress and a better future, it has also always been blamed. For a large part of history, these blames were related to correctional efforts. The school was something to be constantly improved and reformed. Beginning in the second half of the 20th century, however, the school's very existence was called into question. Radical deschoolers made influential pleas to dispatch the school, arguing that the roots of evil lay in scholastic education itself, and that the school is criminal in its institutional logic. There have been made comparisons to prisons and to camps, and not without good reasons. Embedded in the school, so we could and can read, is the false idea that one actually needs the school as an institution to truly learn. We learn much more and much better outside of school. In today's era of lifelong learning and of digital learning environments, one seems to anticipate the school's disappearance on the grounds of its redundancy as a painful, outdated institution. Indeed, besides the recurring charges and accusations leveled against the school, that it is alienating, that it is demotivating young people, that it is reproducing inequality, that it is lacking effectiveness and employability, we must take note of the recent development which states that the school, where learning is bound to time and space, is no longer needed in the digital era of virtual learning environments. The school is simply a product of outdated ways of distributing knowledge and expertise. She is determined by primitive technologies of the past. School is over. That was the title of one of the recent UNESCO publications. So it is here that starts now my defense. And a very defense of the school, and a very important part of that defense is try to identify what makes a school, and why it has value in and of itself. It is very important for me to emphasize that I do that from an educational point of view. So not a sociological one in terms of functions, not a philosophical one in terms of ideas or purposes, not a psychological one in terms of development, not an ethical one in terms of values or norms or interpersonal relations, and not a political one in terms of struggle or interest. Such perspectives are always external, and they always instrumentalize the school for something else outside of school. An educational perspective, so, and I do not say that the other perspectives are not interesting or not important, I just want to develop an educational perspective, is internal and deals with the effective and real operations performed by this particular, artificially composed assembly and arrangement of people, time, space, and matter that constitutes a milieu where people are brought in each other's company and in company of something of the world in a very particular way. School, in the sense that I'm going to try to clarify, is just as democracy an artificial invention and even more politically radical than the one of democracy itself. And it's such, it has indeed nothing to do with the kind of natural or informal learning that is often cherished by those who oppose scholastic forms of learning. So trying to explore what this educational invention is about is not about idealizing the past to romanticize the school, or worse, to return to the past to restore it, not at all. But the main reason is that I think that it is still worthwhile to try to deal with the future of our world and of the future of our coming or the coming generations in this particular way which we call school. School in this sense, and I will call it a pedagogic form, so not an institution but a pedagogic form, is a very particular way to deal with the new generations and to take care of the common world that is disclosed for them and to which they are exposed. It is a way which is different from initiation and socialization. It is education. This means that the school is this form of gathering that takes care of the common world and of the continuation of the common world in such a way that it offers the new generations the possibility for renewal. That means the opportunity to make their own future. That is a future that is not imposed or defined by the older one. A form that implies that society accepts to be slowed down and to be put at a critical distance. A form in which the common world that is at stake and the way to form the new to be fit to take care of that common world. So not that is, I think, what the school is about, is to take care of the common world and to be fit to take care of that world, so not so much about individual development or career. So let me explore some operations of the school. So a major act that makes school is the suspension of a so-called natural unequal order. This is the order that assigns particular activities and rights to particular bodies, as is exemplarily explained in Plato's Myth of the Metals. The story goes that once upon a time, Mother Nature invented all human beings and mixed different metals, gold, silver, bronze, or iron, into their character. Rulers have gold in their characters, workers have iron, and so on for all different classes and professions. So that is the idea. You have a body which is related to some capacities, and it is Mother Nature who mixed these capacities with the bodies. But the school, I think, is the materialization of the belief that humans have no natural destination. It is the materialization of the refusal of natural destiny and the confirmation of homo educabile. Since there is no destiny, men and women can be educated. That means they have to define and find their own destiny. The school materializes this belief by providing scuole, which is the Greek word for free time. That is no productive time. It is thus the separation of two uses of time. What a school did, and thus, if it functions as a school, is to establish a time and space in a sense detached and separated from the time and space and the logic of both society, or the polis, and the household, or the oikos, the economy. The invention of the school constituted an emancipatory rupture. As Jacques Rancière calls it, it is the site of the symbolic visibility of equality and freedom. It is the material refusal of natural destiny and natural order. Or to formulate it differently, school as a pedagogic form is not oriented towards or tamed by a political utopia or an ideal. It is not oriented towards a normative ideal of a person. It is in itself a materialization of a utopian belief. Everybody can learn everything. That means neither what you can learn nor what you have to learn are naturally predefined. So this belief is not a kind of goal or aim, but it is the point of departure. Of course, there are other points of departure possible when it comes to learning. You can say that there is a natural ability and make it a decisive criterion to decide on when, on what to learn, for example. In other words, so instead of thinking about how a utopian school or a utopian educational system would look like, I suggest to look at the school itself and what it does through its pedagogical form as the materialization of the utopian idea that everybody can learn everything. Which would imply that the sheer existence of a school always brings into play the existing social order. That means the existing connections between bodies and capacities, between activities and the implied inequalities. And it implies, on the other hand, that if one introduces in whatever way a predestination, one gives up the scholastic form of learning. It explains that the invention of the school form was from the very beginning also the start of several attempts to tame or neutralize the school. Time and again, there have been attempts to reintroduce some kind of natural order. Today, it is in the word that is used often, at least in Europe, is talent. You have a talent, and we have to develop the talents, and we have to find the talents. That is to introduce, in a certain way, a natural order again. So the school, when it works as a school, and I have to say, it often does not work as a school. I just want to try to say what the school is about, if it is a school, if it is operating as a school. So I think the school offers the experience of being a student or a pupil, not a son or a daughter. School materializes the suspension of the family. It materializes the opportunity to leave behind past and family background, and indeed to become students and pupils like all the rest. Past and background, of course, do not disappear, but when entering the school form, and when it operates as a school form, they are suspended. In fact, people are turned into pupils, from the Latin pupilus, and the first meaning of pupilus is orphan, to have no family. Pupilus means to be an orphan, not in family. So, you are turned into an orphan, into a pupil. So in the sense that you have no father or mother, but also not a family in the national sense, for example. No family, you are a student or a pupil. So hence, school is the visible mark of the acknowledgement of society that our children are not our children. Very often, we approach the school from the viewpoint of family as a place where the looking for identity, the struggle between the father, state, and the mother, family, is played out. However, the school, in the sense that I try to clarify, where everybody becomes a pupil like anyone else, interrupts this identity logic. School is a plural and embodied performativity, a very concrete assembly of bodies saying, we are no family and not becoming one. We are singulars in the plural. They say this without saying, as a bodily enactment. We are not disposable, but call for attention and regard, which means that school interrupts and complicates socialization and initiation. That is why it is education and not socialization and initiation. So the plurality of the school is about addressing everyone as just one. Maram, John, Sarah, and so on. Just one. Yes. Not as a representative. So it is also not about recognizing each person as having its own properties or property, its own talents, its own needs, its own life world, its own tongue. It is about refusing any natural or predefined connection between bodies and their so-called proper characteristics or capacities. So it offers the experience of being without destination, but being able to find one's destination. Clearly, suspension seems no longer to be part of education today. There seems to be the opposite tendency, that is to connect students to their past and family background, to transform teaching into a kind of productive activity, and so not a free time. That is deschooling the school. It is important to mention that to suspend means not to destroy or to ignore, but in English it is said to suspend means to temporarily prevent from being in force or effect. So education as a form of suspension is not destroying or denying anything, the past or the institution, but it is disorientating the institutions, interrupting the past. The necessities and obligations, the imperatives of knowledge, the demands of society, the burden of the family, the projects for the future, everything is there or can be there, but in a condition of suspension, in a condition of floating, the fluid condition, you could say. Suspension could be regarded more generally as an event of deappropriation. It sets free. The term free not only has a negative meaning of suspension, but also meaning that it is free too. A condition of free time is not a place of emptiness, therefore, but a condition in which things, words, practices, are disconnected from their regular use in society or in the family. And hence, it refers to condition in which something of the world is becoming open for common use. And I just want to give this example of the motor. Yeah, the motor that is here, not that is out of the car, like you have it also in the garage, out of the car. But here it's not in the garage, but it's in the school. And that makes a huge difference. Yes. Now, the motor can become the subject of study and exercise. It is not involved in the logic of being immediately instrumentalized again, in the logic of profit and so on, as in the garage where the car has to function again. So it is taken out of function, so to say, in order to put it to our eyes and to our hands so that we can try to relate to it. This operation of the school could be called profanation. Things, however, are not only made profane, but the school makes it possible for the new generation to become attentive for something. Through the figure of the teacher, which plays an important role here, I think, to the role also of school discipline and architecture of school forms, I can come back to that, the school forms attention and makes attentive. And the importance of attention, so not intention, can be formulated differently. The school does not only make things known, but also exposes students to these things and gives them authority or presence, makes them into our company, in a strong sense. The school makes that the common things, the motors, the language, the mathematics, the numbers, can start to speak to the students. So the school does not just offer the opportunity to learn mathematics, but to become interested in mathematics. School is also a space of interesse. So the form of suspension, profanation, and attention is what makes school a public time. It is a time where words are not part, that means no longer and not yet, of a shared language, where things are no longer and not yet a property and to be used according to already familiar guidelines, where acts and movements are not, so no longer, not yet habits of a culture, where thinking is no longer or not yet a system of thought. Things, and I like this image very much, things are put on the table, transforming them into common things, things that are at disposal. What is being suspended by putting them on the table is their economy. That means the reasons and objectives that define them during work or social regular time. Education is precisely the whole of practices to keep the things of the world out of the circles of consumption and the businesses of use and exchange value. Things are thus disconnected from the established or sacred usages of the older generation in society, but not yet appropriated by students or pupils as representatives of the new generation. It is precisely in front of common things available as means that the young generation is offered the opportunity to experience itself as a new generation. The school, I would say, is the materialization of the decision of a society to offer a time and space to all for study, exercise, and thought in order to give the young generation the opportunity to renew society. So that means that the school form, in this sense, is always a way in which society puts itself at distance of itself, brings itself into play. School turns something of the world, for example, a language, into school matter. In all traditional and archaic societies, knowledge and skill is protected and shielded and even kept secret. In contrast, knowledge and skill brought into school becomes an affair of each and all, and in principle does not presuppose any exceptional gift, particular talent, election, or privilege. Of course, knowledge was and still is, in fact, not really equally available in public, and I'm aware of the many exclusions today. At least, to some extent, I am aware of it, and probably I forget some things. The point here that is in principle, that it is in principle, that in principle it is part of the difficult act and belief of making and remaking school. So the school form discussed here clearly maintains something of an initiation to conserve and pass on what the older generation knows about how to live together, about nature, about the world. But the specificity and the real school form of this transmission or this passing on lies in what is transmitted is being detached and released from any community and position, for example, the older generation. So this happens through a public time and place and a language that brings knowledge into play. So knowledge and culture and habits and customs into play in a radical way. It is radical, even possibly revolutionary, for at school, in this sense, everything can always be put under discussion or be questioned. Let me emphasize, so that the school, as I formulated, is not an idea or an ideal, but it is a form of gathering, of bringing together, that is to be made. And pedagogy, I think, is to be understood in its broader sense as the art and technology not just to teach, but to make school happen. That is to spatialize and materialize free time. School pedagogy is about the tracing of spaces, the aesthetical arranging and dealing with matter that sets things free, makes students attentive, places them in the silence of the beginning, and offers the experience of potentiality in front of something that is made public. I cannot go into detail, but I want to stress here that the school pedagogy that aims at constituting the happening of free time includes particular architectures, particular forms of intellectual and bodily or physical discipline. It implies material technologies, specific pedagogic gestures, a particular school language, and certain pedagogical figures like the teacher. Let me just point to a few things. So, first, the possibility, the liberating possibility of the school, and the possibility to relate to the world, is also itself related to what we could call processes of grammatization. Yes, process of grammatization, that means that something is written, and I will try to go to show this. So grammatization is about the externalization and materialization of what usually remains enclosed in certain practices and activities. So school matter is the grammatized version of regular or life word actions, activities, practices, things, and so on. This rupture with the natural and with the life world is precisely essential to make study and exercise possible. Naturally, you will not encounter language turned into letters to be found in the alphabet and the letter box. In nature, you will never see all these birds, and certainly not together and at the same time, in order to be able to compare them. So without this grammatization, this artificial writing of the nature, we deprive children to relate to the world and to what defines them. Therefore, there is indeed a difference between learning by doing and scholastic learning. Even if indeed grammars are often boring and in terms of immediate use often very useless, it is the knowledge of the grammars in a very broad sense that allows us not to be just absorbed in and by activities, but to be engaged and at a distance. So to escape from being imprisoned or locked in one's life world. So grammatization is needed. Related to the teacher, I cannot go very deep into it, but I think the being a teacher, there are many aspects of being a teacher, but one I think is the issue of love. That a teacher should have a loving ethos, but it's a double love. It's the love for the subject, but it's also the love for the new generation, and both loves complicate each other, and they make each other more complicated. So the teacher plays a role in presenting the world to the student in such a way that this world becomes interesting, that the animals start to speak, so to say, that the viruses start to speak, that the landscape starts to speak, but also in such a way that it is not just imposing something on the student, but that the student can take it distance. So at once it is a passion, but it is a passion that allows the other to go into it or not, to take a distance also of it. Very important also, I think, for the school form is that it involves more than one student. And I don't want to say that we need many, 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 many students, but I think school is always about more than one student. Individual education, or focus exclusively on so-called individual learning pathways, is not a form of school education. This is because it is only by addressing the group that the teacher is exactly put in a vulnerable position. As every teacher knows, if you enter classroom with many students, there is a group that you are not able to totally control. Yes, that's important. It's putting the teacher in a vulnerable position. Yes, it is helping to lower or to weaken his authority. So it is by addressing the group that the teacher is put in a vulnerable position and is forced to speak to each one, but also to no one in particular, and thus to everyone. A purely individual relationship is not possible or is constantly interrupted. So the teacher is obliged to speak publicly. It is totally different when I am in a one-to-one situation than I am speaking before a group. So this is a scholastic discipline that is imposed by the group of students on the teacher. And that means also that on the side of the students, the pupils, the experience of being able to start with something, to begin with something, is a shared experience from the outset. It is the experience of belonging to a new generation in relation to something from the old world. So a community of students in this sense is a unique community. It is a community of people who have nothing yet in common, but by confronting what is brought to the table, what is on the table, its members can experience what it means to share something and activate their ability to renew the world. Of course, there are many differences between students, clothing, religion, gender, background, culture, but in the classroom, and by concentrating on what is brought to the table, those differences are temporarily suspended at the moment that the subject matter becomes interested. Fourth, almost to my final point, so regarding the language of the school, I just want to say, I cannot go into that point, but that the language of the school is also an artificial language. That means it is a language that is always marked by the subject matter, that it is a language which is always close to some extent to the language of science, that means the abstract language, but also always close to the poetic language, because it is about inviting people without imposing something, without convincing or conversing. It is the language of scientists and poets, not of priests. So it is always artificial. And in school, the language that is used in school always have to become itself a matter of study. It must be studied itself. Because at that moment that it is studied, it starts to be not natural anymore, and you can relate to it. And at school, that's the last thing about language. At school, I think there should be always more than one language. And I understood, I don't know if that is the case, so I cannot, maybe I'm wrong, but I think that in this context, in the Israeli context, if you think starting from the school, and if the experience of language is important, then you should have at least two languages in each school, that means Hebrew and Arabic. Yes, in both. So that is something that you should have as an experience of translatability. That's related to the notion of school. So to summarize that, school is saying, you have time. We give you time. Today, I don't know how this is here, but in my context, having time is something which we don't have. And we have the experience, we have no time anymore. We are constantly busy. Yes? School is saying, no, we give you time. It's gift of time where you don't have to produce, don't have to function, don't have to adapt, to operate, to make, or to create, but where you can contemplate and study and exercise. School is saying, our children are not our children. Here, you are not our son or our daughter, but you have a future and you can find your own destiny. School is saying everybody can learn everything. So here, we don't believe in natural destination, in no natural connection between bodies and capacities. School is saying the world belongs to no one. Here, there is no property, but there is world to be commoned, shared, and become shared. So school, if it functions as a school, if it operates as a school, allows for radical experiences. The experience of being no family. Here we are a collective, but not as a family. Here we are able, there is no destination. Here the world can be questioned. The world has to be considered. That means we have to take distance from the world, but in order to take care of the common world. So we have to contemplate it and not just adjust to the world or function or operate in it. So it is an arrangement and an assembly to offer minors, and you could say also minorities, minors, at once the opportunity to define their own destination as a way to take care of our common world and to question directly or indirectly what adults value or present to them. Okay, I have only 5 minutes left. I'm sorry. So let me say I say one more thing about the taming, and then something about the training of teachers. So maybe today, be just a school, has become problematic in a way which is much more radical than all the attempts to tame and colonize the school that have accompanied it since its invention, out of fear or even hatred for the school, just like the fear and the hatred for democracy. I think it is our duty as educational theorists to take the notion of school out of the hands of those of using it only to express political, economic, and ethical frustrations or expectations. That means to see the school purely as instrumental. If school doesn't meet someone's expectations, and especially the ones of the older generation, is it not always also because young people do not meet expectations, and hence that they do not fit or want to fit the image we have in mind for them? Deschooling refers to the opposite assumption that society has to impose or propose or project a destiny on young people through developing their so-called natural talents, to projecting a predefined image of the educated person or of the competent person today. I am not disqualifying this and other outcome-oriented forms of learning. These are initiations and socializations, or on-the-job trainings, for example. But I want to indicate that school learning is different. School learning is about offering material and school stuff, subject matter, in order to shape oneself. That means in order to be able to relate to the world and not just to function in it. It is to offer the grammar in order to allow people to become literate, yet without deciding in advance the ideal image of the literate person to allow the common world to be taken care of. So I wanted to talk about the challenges today to the school. They are related to the fact that school time is today actually itself defined as productive time. We have to produce learning outcomes. That's the language of the USO. So no difference between production time and study time. It is the same kind of time. It is also about, very strongly, at least in my context, about personal learning, about adapting to personal needs, about personal learning paths. I think that has nothing to do with education. Education is not the development of personal learning paths, but is the confrontation with world, with something outside of myself, not myself. I think so that these challenges, and one of the maybe the most important challenge or related to it, is what ICT is doing to school, what the things that we have in our hands constantly, or that we are looking at constantly, what are they doing to school? So how is it possible to make school in these conditions? I think this is a very, very strong challenge. And I want to propose, what I wanted to propose, or what I wanted to say about the teacher education and the identity of teachers. And that's will be the final thing. So I think that the professional identity of teachers is not to be related just to teaching, but to make school. That is complicating the act of teaching, and for very good reasons, for reasons that I want to defend. Not because it is effective and efficient. That's like democracy. You don't have to defend democracy because it's effective and efficient, because it is not. But you have to defend it maybe because it is more just. Yes. So the school is not the most effective and efficient way to learn. No, of course not. It is complicating the learning, but for good reasons. For good reasons for that. So I think that what would be part of teacher education is the things that I've been referring to, this double love, the development of a certain ethos, a certain way of speaking, a kind of artificial language, yes, indeed, a kind of artificial language that you speak because you don't want to initiate, but you want to offer people the possibility to relate what you are saying, not just initiate them or convert them in what you think you have to. It is, of course, a subject. You have to study a subject matter, because you have to be able to pass over a kind of passion, or kind of love, they say. But I think also that precisely in view of all kinds of social and technological developments, the conditions in which to make school today, and you could add, of course, social, political, technical developments, those conditions in which to make school are changing rapidly and are affecting school and its inhabitants in very different ways. I think it is very illusionary, and even more than it was before, that you would be able to formulate the concrete competences that could be used as learning outcomes to be reached and to direct the formation of teachers. I think that's an illusion, precisely because of the challenges, and nobody really knows how to deal with them. So, in fact, we do not know what becomes of school education under current conditions. Therefore, it seems that teacher training that would be organized by predefined competences is something very difficult. That does not mean that we don't need competences, but you cannot just organize that as such. So I suggest that teacher formation should be reconceived as a kind of school studies, where students, together with their teachers, study what is actually happening to school education and therefore try to develop together response ability, the ability to respond through collective study. So school studies is not yet an established discipline, but it's a field of study that has to be composed by students and professors together, creating and constituting also their study material together. So I think that that is what teacher training should be about. I will not say it anymore, but you can read it if you want. There is a very, very nice quote of Gaston Bachelard, which I think is something which we should cherish. He's saying, so one says, time and again, that it is the task of the school to prepare the child for society. One uses a war metaphor. We have to arm our youth for the battles of life and society. In short, the school is made for society. But wouldn't it be not more clear, more sweet within the heart of people if we would reverse the proposition and say the society is made for the school, or has to be made for the school? The school is the aim, is an aim. We owe body and soul to the coming generation. Thank you.